Thank you very much. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Nicola Sturgeon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In this statement, I will update Parliament on the Scottish Government's assessment of the course of the pandemic now and on the decisions that flow from that in relation to the levels of protection that will apply to each local authority area from Saturday. In addition, I indicated at the end of last week that I would give an update on the situation in Glasgow by no later than Wednesday, and I can confirm that I'll also do that today. However, before any of that, I'll report on today's statistics. The total number of positive cases reported yesterday was 478, which is 3.1% of the total number of tests conducted. The total number of confirmed cases, therefore, is now 236,389. 106 people are currently in hospital, which is 4 fewer than yesterday, and 10 people are receiving intensive care. That is 2 more than yesterday. I'm also relieved to say that no deaths were reported yesterday, and that means the total number of deaths registered under the daily definition remains at 7,669. But again, I want to convey my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. I'll also give an update on the vaccination programme. As of 7:30 this morning, 3,267,290 people had received their first dose of the vaccine. That is around 72% of the adult population, and it represents an increase of 16,152 since yesterday. In addition, 30,978 people received a second dose yesterday, and that brings the total number of second doses now to 2,075,231, and that represents, the total number represents around 46% of the adult population. Presiding Officer, the decisions we have arrived at today are difficult and complex ones, and this reflects the fact that we are currently at a delicate and fragile point in what we very much hope is a transition to a different way of dealing with this virus. In summary, we do believe that vaccinations are opening the path to a less restrictive way of dealing with COVID, one that is less driven by case numbers. But because not all adults have been fully vaccinated with 2 doses to date, we are not quite there yet. And as we make this transition, just to compound the challenge further, we're also dealing with a new, faster spreading variant. This is, of course, a new development that has arisen since we set out our indicative route map back in March. All of this means that at this critical stage, to avoid being knocked off course completely, we must still err on the side of caution. And I'll share more detail of all of this now. The considerable downside that we face just now is the Indian or April 02 variant, which was renamed last night by the World Health Organization as Delta. This variant is spreading faster than previous variants of the virus, and we now believe that it accounts for well over half of our new daily cases. Because of that, Scotland's R number is almost certainly above 1 right now. And as we know from past painful experience, that makes our situation highly precarious. Indeed, many public health experts are warning that the UK could, and I stress could, now be at the start of a third wave of the virus. And obviously, it would be wrong to completely ignore that warning. However, and this is the considerable upside, we now have a significant advantage that we did not have in the first or the second wave. We are increasingly confident that the vaccines are effective, though we're closely monitoring the vaccination status of people admitted to hospital. But we do now have evidence that the link between cases and serious illness, hospitalisation and deaths does appear to be weakening. For example, since January in Scotland, the proportion of new cases which lead to hospital admission has reduced on current estimates from 10% to 5%, although it is important to say that we're still assessing the recent impact of the new variant. In addition, the length of time people are spending in hospital has also been reducing quite markedly since the new year, though again, we are monitoring this data closely and carefully. So the emerging evidence is providing us with a firm basis to believe that in this next coming phase of the pandemic, we will be able to deal with the virus differently and less restrictively. However, and this is why I have described our current situation as a transition, although we are vaccinating as quickly as possible and trying to speed up as much as possible, there is still a sizeable proportion of the population not yet fully vaccinated. And full vaccination is vital. Protection against the Delta variant after one dose is not negligible, but it is not substantial either. It is after two doses that the protection becomes much stronger. So if cases continue to rise significantly for too long a period of time, while significant numbers are not fully vaccinated, we could still see a significant burden of illness and death and severe pressure on our NHS. And it might also be worth just pausing to reflect at this stage on what protecting the NHS, which has been a key aim throughout this pandemic, means in the current context. After coping with the pandemic for more than a year, the NHS is now seeking to get non-COVID treatment back on track. That means protecting the NHS can't just be about preventing it from being completely overwhelmed, although that is, of course, vital. It must also be about protecting its ability to get services back to normal. So even though the health service coped earlier this year, when more than 2,000 people were in hospital, albeit, I should say, with enormous pressure on the workforce, that shouldn't be our benchmark. Anything remotely like that again would set back our efforts to get the NHS operating normally again. So this is a key and a difficult moment. We do remain on the right track overall. I remain confident that with cautious, albeit difficult decisions now, we will enjoy much greater normality over the summer and beyond. None of our decisions today, even in the face of rising case numbers, take us backwards. And while I know it's hard to think in these terms more than a year into a pandemic, that does represent real progress from the start of this year. Back then, remember, a new variant and rising case numbers did take us backwards into a full lockdown. That is not the case now, and because of the vaccination programme, we can still look ahead with confidence. But, and this is the difficult part, in areas where cases are relatively high or rising, our judgment is that a slight slowing down of the easing of restrictions to allow time for more people to be fully vaccinated will help protect that progress overall. And that leads me to the decisions that we are setting out today. Now, it's important to recognise that the picture across the country is not uniform, and so our decisions are not uniform either. That is the benefit of the level system. We don't need to apply a one-size-fits-all approach with the same levels of restrictions in areas with low or more contained case numbers as we do in areas with high or rising numbers. However, a variable system also has its downsides. It is more complex. It is impossible to remove every anomaly. It's not without risk, and of course it can lead to a sense of inequity. That is why it is important to set out as clearly as possible why different areas are subject to different restrictions, while recognising that these decisions are complex. So let me turn to those decisions. And given that it has been in a unique situation for the past couple of weeks, I will talk about Glasgow first and separately. I reported on Friday that the situation in Glasgow appeared to be stabilising, and I'm pleased to say that this remains the case. Indeed, case numbers have fallen slightly in recent days, from 146 cases per 100,000 people to 129. And this provides further evidence that the major public health interventions we've seen in the past few weeks are having an impact. In addition, although hospital admissions are rising, the vaccination effect means that they are not, at least at this stage, increasing as fast as they might have done from a similar level of cases earlier in the year. It's also important, of course, that we consider the harms caused by the virus alongside the other harms that ongoing restrictions cause. These include wider health harms, social harms and economic harms. And these wider harms are not insignificant in Glasgow, given that it is now more than 8 months since, for example, we were last allowed to visit each other in our homes. So taking all of this into account and with the support of the National Incident Management Team, I can confirm that Glasgow City will move down to level 2 from midnight on Friday into Saturday. This means that people in Glasgow, as has been the case in most of the rest of Scotland since mid-May, will be able to meet in homes in groups of no more than six from a maximum of three households. It also means that indoor licensed hospitality can reopen and that people can travel again between Glasgow and other parts of Scotland. A number of venues will also be permitted to reopen and outdoor adult contact sports can resume. These changes are significant. As someone who lives in Glasgow, I know they will make a huge difference to quality of life. But I ask everyone to remember that although stable and starting to decline, cases in Glasgow do still remain high. So please continue to be cautious. In particular, and this actually applies to all of Scotland, particularly while we enjoy some better weather, although limited indoor meetings are now possible, it is still better to stay outdoors where possible. And in level two, groups of up to eight people from eight households can gather outdoors. The last 8 months and perhaps the last couple of weeks in particular have been really tough for Glasgow, so I want to thank everyone who has cooperated with all the public health measures and stuck to all of the rules and guidelines. I'll now turn to other parts of the country, and I'm going to first set out the difficult part of this statement. There are a number of other local authority areas in addition to Glasgow that are not currently meeting the criteria for level one, either in case numbers or test positivity. Indeed, if we looked at just the raw numbers, it could be argued that some of these areas should be in level three. However, our judgment, based on the emerging evidence of the impact of vaccines that I spoke about a moment ago on hospitalisation, and our assessment of local factors and public health interventions, is that level three would not be proportionate at this stage. However, it is also our judgment that with case numbers as high as they are in these areas and with a substantial proportion of adults not yet double dosed, it is safer and more likely to protect our progress overall if we hold these areas in level two for a further period. In addition to Glasgow, this applies to Edinburgh and Midlothian, Dundee, East Dunbartonshire, Renfrewshire and East Renfrewshire, the three Ayrshires, North and South Lanarkshire and Clackmannanshire and Stirling. Now, I know this will be disappointing, very disappointing for people in these areas. For these local authority areas, I should say we will be providing support to soft play and other closed sectors that had expected to open or operate in a different way from 7th June, and full details will be provided by the Finance Secretary tomorrow. But it is important to stress that this is a pause, not a step backwards. And level two is not lockdown. It does have an impact on opening hours of pubs and restaurants and the numbers that can attend certain events. But we can still meet indoors in limited numbers and outdoors in groups of eight from eight households. Hospitality remains open indoors and outdoors. So does retail. And there are no travel restrictions in place. And taking a cautious approach now, while more people get fully vaccinated, does give us the best chance of staying on the right track overall. So to everyone in these areas, please continue to be careful, follow all of the important guidance on hygiene, distancing and face coverings, keep getting tested and come forward to be vaccinated as soon as you get the opportunity. In more positive news, there are many parts of mainland Scotland where cases are at very low levels and broadly stable, or where case numbers might appear to be rising, but we are assured that they relate to clusters that are being managed. So I can confirm that the following areas will move to level one from 1 minute past midnight on Saturday morning. Those areas are Highland, Argyll and Bute, Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire, Moray, Angus, Perth and Kinross, Falkirk, Fife, Inverclyde, East and West Lothian, West Dunbartonshire, Dumfries and Galloway and the Borders. The full detail of what that means are set out on the Scottish Government website, but the main changes are as follows. The limits on meetings in indoor public places increase to eight people from three households and outdoors to 12 people from 12 households. 100 people as opposed to 50 can attend weddings and funerals, and places like soft play and fun fairs can reopen. Again, I know these changes will be welcome, but please continue to be careful. That applies to all of us right now, and in particular, it applies that meeting outdoors involves much less risk than meeting indoors. Finally, Shetland, Orkney and the Western Isles and a number of small remote islands are already in level one. These communities are continuing to report extremely low numbers of new cases, and in many cases a higher than average proportion of adults have received both doses of the vaccine. So these areas will move to level zero again from a minute past midnight on Saturday morning. Full details of what those changes mean can also be found on our website, but for example, it means that people can meet indoors in groups of up to four households. Local licensing laws apply in hospitality. There's no set nationwide closing time, and it means that the maximum attendance at weddings and funerals will be 200 rather than 100 at level one and 50 at level two. Again, though, as well as asking islanders to exercise continued care, I would remind anyone travelling to any of the islands to use a lateral flow test before doing so. That way you will minimise the risk of taking the virus to any of these communities. Signing officer, I appreciate that today's decisions will feel like, and indeed are, a mixed bag. That reflects the fact that we are in a transition phase. The vaccines do make the outlook positive, but the new variant means that the road ahead is still potentially bumpy. So caution is necessary. That said, no part of the country is going backwards today. Before the vaccines, that would have been impossible on case numbers like these. But the vaccines are changing the game, and that means we can still be optimistic, very optimistic, about our chances of much more normality over this summer and beyond. Indeed, in the days ahead, and while it might still feel a way off for many of us, we will publish more detailed work on what we expect life beyond level zero to look like as that greater normality hopefully returns. Indeed, one reason for proceeding with more caution now is to make it easier in future to resume that progress to level zero and then beyond. My last point, and this is the one I will finish on, is that, as always, all of us have a part to play in beating the virus back. So please get tested regularly. Free lateral flow tests are available through the NHS Inform website. I would encourage, again, everyone to order these and test yourself twice a week. The lateral flow tests give results in about half an hour, so they're a very quick and useful way of finding out if you might have the virus, even if you don't have any symptoms. Essentially, the more we all get tested, the more cases we find and the more we break chains of transmission. So getting tested regularly is a way for all of us to contribute to the collective effort. And secondly, make sure you get vaccinated when you're invited to do so. That includes going for second doses. To repeat what I said earlier, second doses are vital in providing substantial protection against the virus and in particular this new variant of it. If you can't make an appointment, and there will often be good reasons why that's the case, then please make sure you rearrange it. If you haven't received an appointment letter yet and think you should have, you can go to the vaccinations page of the NHS Inform website to arrange your appointment. Getting vaccinated is in all of our own best interests. Whatever age we are, it makes it much less likely that we will become badly ill from COVID. But it's also part of our wider civic duty to each other. It means that all of us can help suppress the virus and reduce the harm that it causes. And that will allow us to get to that phase of being able to deal with this in a less restrictive way than has been the case. And finally, I would ask everybody to please continue to stick to the rules where you live and follow the public health advice. Physical distancing, hand washing, face coverings, all of this is still important for now. These basic precautions will reduce our chances of getting or spreading the virus. So in summary, please get tested regularly, get vaccinated when you're asked, and continue to follow the public health advice. If we all do that, then despite a pause for part of the country today, we can keep on the right track and we can then make progress over the summer to living much less restricted lives. So let me end by thanking again everyone across the country for helping us do exactly that.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I had hoped to say that today's statement is, at least broadly, a move in the right direction. And for the people of Glasgow, the move to level 2 from Saturday will be a most welcome step to bring to an end 277 days of our largest city living under some of the toughest restrictions. But for people all over the country, in 14 of the 32 local council areas, today's statement is a disappointing setback. Half of the country will move forward, while the rest remains stuck in limbo, with no clear idea of when the restrictions will ease. We understand the need for caution, but we also believe more emphasis needs to be placed on the impact of these restrictions on businesses, on jobs, and on people's mental and physical health. We believe a more local approach is necessary, with targeted interventions to tackle local outbreaks instead of sweeping measures. The approach of council-wide restrictions is now out of date. It was designed before we had an effective, successful vaccination scheme. The First Minister herself said in her statement, 72% of adults in Scotland have now had the first dose of the vaccine, and 46% of adults in Scotland are now protected with both doses of the vaccine. The First Minister also said today that we don't need to apply a one-size-fits-all approach. But it seems that's exactly what's happening. Keeping whole councils or cities in level 2 is not targeted. It's not a local approach. So let me ask the First Minister, will she consider moving to an approach of targeted interventions instead of council-wide restrictions? I'm sorry that some SNP members feel the need to heckle, but we have had 20 minutes of a statement from the First Minister on an extremely important issue for our country, and it's now appropriate, we don't get this on the BBC, I know, it's now appropriate for opposition politicians to question the government. That is healthy in a democracy. So could I also ask the First Minister, what plans are in place to speed up vaccinations for areas with local outbreaks beyond the measures already set out? What further support can businesses expect? While the Finance Secretary will update Parliament tomorrow, has the First Minister looked into the issues that I raised last week from the Glasgow Chambers of Commerce, for example, that said funding promised has not been delivered to businesses? Can the First Minister inform the public what evidence there is of an imminent severe pressure on the NHS, as she outlined in her statement? And finally, how will the government ensure public compliance with the restrictions that have been set out when, after more than a year of their lives being upheaval in their lives over the last year, and with hospitalisations at such a low rate, people really are at the end of their tether?
First Minister.
Well, I think the first thing I would say, Presiding Officer, is whether people in this chamber, or indeed across the country, agree or disagree with the decisions I'm taking, and it's perfectly legitimate to question them and indeed to disagree with them. I hope everyone will accept that I don't take, and the government doesn't take, any of these decisions lightly. I absolutely long for the day that I can stand here and say no more restrictions are required anywhere in Scotland. There is no part of me that wants to hold us back from that for a single second longer than is necessary. But it is really important at this juncture, if we are to keep our progress moving overall in the right direction, that we are cautious and careful. I've been criticised, and again, it is perfectly legitimate for people to do so, for erring on the side of caution at various points over the past 14 months or so. And I don't pretend that the decisions I or the government have taken have been perfect, far from it. But every time we have erred on the side of caution, I think time has told that that was the correct or necessary thing to have done, and it's important that we do so now. We're not taking a one-size-fits-all. If we were taking a pure public health approach to this, and indeed there will be some public health voices who might prefer that this is what we are doing today, we would simply have held the whole of the country in the levels they are at right now. On some of the raw figures, it can be argued, or could be argued, that some areas should be at a higher level. We are taking all of the different factors into account, not least the progress with vaccination. If I can give just one example, to illustrate that point, in Highland, you look at case numbers in Highland right now and they look as if they are going in the wrong direction quite fast. But we know that there is a particular issue, particularly around the Fort William area. We know it's being managed, so we are not applying higher restrictions to Highland overall. We're allowing the public health interventions to do their work, just as we did in Clackmannanshire and in East Renfrewshire in the last few weeks. So we are taking a targeted approach, but we also have to recognise travel patterns and the interactions between different areas. This is not perfect, it's not ideal, but we are taking the most proportionate and balanced approach that we can. Just briefly to refer to some of the other points, you don't have to go very far to hear public health experts warning against a lack of caution right now, but also pointing to the fact that while the vaccination is proving to be effective, all of the news on vaccination is good, but we still have around 50, slightly more than 50% of the adult population that haven't had both doses. And while that is the case, we remain vulnerable to this new, faster spreading variant. That's why we need to be cautious. Vaccinations are speeding up. Again, just for example, today we've reported just under 31,000 second doses. Yesterday that was 21,500. So we are speeding up on vaccination and continue to do that and to make it more flexible as well. I did not say the health service was at imminent risk of severe pressure. What I said was, and this again is based on public health advice, is if we don't act with caution, it is possible that from that unvaccinated, or rather not fully vaccinated, pool, we would still start to see hospital numbers go up. And the other key point I made is that while earlier this year the NHS coped at 2,000 COVID patients at peak, we don't want to get back to anything like that, because that means the health service virtually can't do anything else. We're trying to get the health service back to normal. President Officer, I'm sure I've missed some of the points here. I will end with this. I do not want to keep a single part of this country in tougher restrictions or any restrictions for longer than necessary. But I do have a duty to continue to navigate us through this safely, where necessary, cautiously, so that we can keep our progress on overall. And the very last point in response to Douglas Ross, level two is still tough. I don't pretend otherwise. It is not lockdown, though, and we don't do anybody any favours by suggesting it is. We can go into each other's homes. We can see hospitality open, stay open indoors. So there are significant steps forward there that are important for businesses and for the mental and physical health of the population.
I call Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, this is largely welcome news for people in Glasgow and many across the country, but I know for many in those parts of Scotland that were expecting to move down a level, this news will come as a bitter blow. I want to focus on our response in the hotspot areas, and it's paramount that we now design proper protocols for what happens in current and future hotspot areas, learning from the Glasgow experience. Those protocols must include walk-in vaccination centres for everyone aged over 18, the mass rollout of PCR tests, increased support for local businesses and greater access to isolation support grants. That must be our first point of call in future outbreaks, not further lockdowns which damage the economy and have a negative effect on people's mental health and well-being. Glasgow has been a hotspot area for now almost 3 weeks, but it remains the second lowest level of vaccine uptake of any local authority across the country, and we still don't have walk-in vaccination centres for people aged over 18 and above. At the same time, we are hearing daily stories about unattended appointments and large-scale unattended appointments. So what urgent investigations have the government done? What steps are being taken to address these large-scale missed appointments, and what urgent action has been taken to make sure we can increase the performance of vaccine uptake in those hotspot areas? When will we have walk-in vaccination clinics for people aged 18 and over in hotspot areas? And will the First Minister commit to publish hotspot protocols for future outbreaks?
First Minister.
These are all perfectly reasonable and legitimate points. If I can run through them, hopefully more briefly than I did in my previous answer, Presiding Officer, one by one. Over the past few days, I've heard people not surprisingly say, in relation to Glasgow, why aren't we going door to door with testing? Why don't we have drop-in vaccination clinics? Why don't we have surge tests? All of that was happening in Glasgow and has been happening in Glasgow over the past couple of weeks. And that is why we believe we're seeing the situation in Glasgow not continue with exponential rise, but stabilise and now start to decline. So the lessons in Glasgow are important, and it's important that they can be applied and are applied elsewhere. So I'm going to use a different word just because it's the one we're using in government. There is a toolkit being prepared that is taking the lessons and the learning from Glasgow and making that available to all other health boards. The Health Secretary is meeting with all health board chief executives tomorrow to talk about the importance of that as well as the wider issue. I certainly, I'm sure it is very technical in many respects, but I'm certainly more than happy to look at how we publish something that is available to the public to know what should be expected. Not when hotspot areas become hotspot areas, but when there is any emerging evidence that that is the direction of travel. In terms of vaccination, there's a couple of things that I know people do understand in vaccination. We need to, firstly, make sure we have the supplies to do everything. Supply continues to be our biggest constraint, but it's even more complicated than that because we have different vaccines and they can be used differently for different age groups. So in terms of Pfizer, for example, which is being used for the younger age groups, that is where supply is tighter than it is with AstraZeneca. So we've got to balance all of that. And secondly, but most importantly, we know that the most vital thing we do, getting over 18s with their first dose is important, and appointments have already started in Glasgow with that, and we will look, as supplies allow, at having drop-in clinics. But getting people who've had their first dose with their second dose is what increases substantially the level of protection from the vaccine. So that's why over the next few weeks, there will deliberately be an emphasis on completing second doses. So all of this is important. All of this is work that is underway, and we continue every single day to do what we can. Back at the start of the year, I wasn't the only one that did this, but used the terminology of the race, you know, the vaccine against the virus. We're going as fast as we can with the vaccine, and we've got to continue to look for ways to speed up. Unfortunately, though, the virus keeps learning to run faster. And that is the big challenge that we're up against right now. And that is what makes these decisions still as difficult as they are.
I call Lorna Slater to be followed by Willie Rennie.
The First Minister is aware just how challenging the pandemic has been on household budgets. Many people have spent much of the last year on the furlough scheme, earning 80% of what might have been an already low wage. Others have lost their jobs completely, with little hope of finding another. The eviction ban has been a lifeline for people, but that protection has been swept away, and many face eviction now if they can't cover their rent. The job prospects of a recovery just aren't there yet. Will the First Minister give urgent consideration to reinstating the eviction ban across the whole country for as long as COVID restrictions remain in place?
First Minister.
Yes, we'll keep all of these things under consideration. The ban on evictions, of course, was extended for level 4 and level 3 areas, but of course, as of Saturday, no part of Scotland will be in level 3, so we need to continue to consider the nature of our response. I don't underestimate, because we have extended it on more than one occasion now, I think, the importance of the eviction ban, but it's also important that we do as much as we can to help people with the causes of rent arrears and to help them deal with those rent arrears. So, for example, the loan fund that we set up to help people who are having difficulty paying their rent is important as well, getting more money into people's pockets through help for low-income families. So this needs to be a package of measures, and we will continue to keep that under ongoing review.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Elena Witham.
The limited easing is positive for many. I'm concerned, deeply concerned, about the lack of services for adults with special needs. After a year, it's certainly taken its toll on them. One family told me, we feel completely let down and abandoned. Does the First Minister agree that if we can open up pubs and football fan zones, we should be restarting community services for adults with special needs?
First Minister.
Absolutely recognise how difficult this has been for everybody, but particularly for people who already were vulnerable, and adults with special needs are definitely in that category. And I know Willie Rennie does ask people to, as far as possible in a really difficult circumstance, take in good faith that we're trying to manage these issues as carefully and as sensitively as we can, with safety absolutely paramount. I do think now we are in a phase where more of services that Willie Rennie is talking about get back to normal. I understand why people compare events with services like this. Often there are very different issues at play, and it can be an oversimplification to do that, although I understand why people do. We want to get all of the services that are most important for people back as quickly as possible. And if I can widen the point slightly to the NHS, it's why I don't think we should just be complacent about saying, well, we've only got 100 in hospital today. We know the health service can cope with 2,000. We don't want to get anywhere near that, because that means we have to pull back again on non-COVID services. So some of this caution today is about trying to open up as much of the normal service provision across the piece as we possibly can. And I give an assurance that adults with learning disabilities, that with for groups with vulnerabilities, they remain absolutely at the top of our list of priorities.
Helena Whittam, to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister if the Scottish Government has assessed the impact COVID-19 and the resultant isolation has had on those with mobility issues, and whether more physiotherapy services are needed, particularly for our elderly citizens and those with disabilities, to stop possible early and preventable admittance to care home settings.
First Minister.
Thank you very much. I think this is the first opportunity I've had to formally welcome Helena Whittam to Parliament. It's good to see her here. The COVID pandemic has, as I was just reflecting on to Willie Rennie, it's had an effect on everyone, but on everyone in different ways. That undoubtedly includes the impact of decreased activity on mobility and independence. The rehabilitation framework highlights the importance of access to rehabilitation and self-management for everyone, and that includes access to specific services like physiotherapy, but also the importance of supported activities in a local community and supported self-management across the health and care system. So again, these areas remain priorities for us to support and get back to normal as quickly as possible.
Miles Briggs, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome you to your position? First Minister, I've been contacted by a number of constituents who have told me that their emergency accommodation in guest houses and service departments here in the capital will be terminated as of yesterday, with no information about where they will be going, and in breach of the four-week notice Council should be providing. Now, during the pandemic, welcome steps have been taken to provide accommodation for homeless individuals and families. So can I ask the First Minister, what is the Scottish Government's position on this critical issue? And will the First Minister also agree to ministers bringing forward a statement on post-pandemic homelessness strategy and policy before this Parliament breaks for summer recess?
First Minister.
On the specific issue, I'm more than happy to look at the detail if Miles Briggs wants to send it to me. Obviously, it's principally a matter for the Council, but I'm happy to look at it in terms of what the Scottish Government might be able to do. More generally, we, at the start of the pandemic, through a lot of joint working, made significant inroads into reducing homelessness and rough sleeping, and it is absolutely essential that we continue that as we come out of this pandemic, and that is a key area of work that the Government is taking forward. We will publish plans, or updated plans on that, as quickly as possible. But on the specific, I'm, as I say, happy to look at the detail and reply in more depth if that is necessary.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the announcement, First Minister, that borders will be moving to level one, but I want to focus on the vaccination rollout, because I've had constituents failed by the National Vaccine Helpline and the missing appointments process. And I ask, therefore, that an assessment is made of the efficacy of these processes, including asking the public what their experience was. It is a minority, a small minority, but it's very stressful for that minority.
First Minister.
I think it is stressful for any individual who, for whatever reason, is finding it difficult to access their appointment. I think it is a minority, but if you're in that position, that doesn't matter to you to hear me say it is a minority. The overall programme is working incredibly well, and that's not just me saying that. That can be seen from the figures that we are reporting every day. As we go through this programme, we are trying to make changes where we can, if those can improve the experience for people. We are trying to make it more flexible. The walk-in vaccination clinics that have been operating in Glasgow, for example. I think we want to see more of that flexible walk-in approach taken across the country. That said, we also need to make sure that the systems we have in place, we stick with them to get through the programme as quickly as possible. Of course, it will be important that we reflect when we get to the end of this first programme, since I suspect this will not be a one-off vaccination programme, that we do take stock, that we hear the experiences of people, and we try to evolve and develop the system in future if we've not been able to do that as we go along. But I, notwithstanding the difficulties some individuals are having, I do want again to pay tribute to people who are working so hard to deliver this programme in every single community across the country.
Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Can I also welcome the announcement about Western Bartonshire and Argyll and Bute moving to level one? The majority of people are getting their vaccinations, and that is welcome. Unfortunately, that's not the experience of some of my constituents as well. Some people are waiting more than 12 weeks for their second dose. At one clinic, people were sent home because supplies of Pfizer had run out, and people in Western Bartonshire were told to go for their vaccination to the Hydro or Easter House, breaking the law by travelling into a level three area. As the First Minister accelerates the programme across the country, can she try to ensure that vaccinations are delivered as locally as possible?
First Minister.
Just to reassure MD in that position, of course, it is not breaking the law to travel to another area for an essential purpose, which getting a vaccine. But of course, that's not what we want in the bulk of cases. Issues of supply, we are restricted by supply, and that is one of the factors that unfortunately is out with our control. We are trying to strike the right balance. It's never going to be a perfect balance between very local access for people and mass vaccination clinics that get people through as quickly as possible. But there will be some people for whom travel to a mass vaccination clinic is not desirable or possible, and therefore that's why people have the ability to reschedule and rebook appointments. With a programme of this scale being introduced and implemented at this pace, I wish I could say otherwise, but it is not going to be absolutely perfect on every occasion for everybody. There are lots and lots of people, not least in government, although that's the least of it across the country, working hard to avoid difficulties for individuals. The programme is going well, and we continue to try to iron out and improve any issues that individuals are experiencing, and that process will continue.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. Can I ask the First Minister for an update on the take-up of vaccine registrations for the over-18s in Ayrshire and what action has been taken there to combat no-shows, given the recent increase in case numbers in parts of the county?
First Minister.
We've seen good uptake of registration of 18 to 29-year-olds across the country, but also in Ayrshire using the online portal. I'm sure get the precise figure for Willie Coffey, but I'm not aware of any particular difference between the Ayrshire figure and the figure for Scotland as a whole. NHS Ayrshire and Arran has also written to all those who didn't attend their appointment to invite them to arrange a subsequent appointment. A second letter to all those who didn't attend their appointment has been sent nationally again, inviting them to reschedule. There's been a drop-in clinic for those who missed their first dose. There was one on the 23rd of May at Kilwinning Academy. I know the Health Board is planning a further drop-in session as well, and additionally carrying out outreach vaccinations to support their inclusivity plans. So this is an ongoing process. Nobody who doesn't turn up for their vaccine appointment will simply be forgotten. There will be considerable efforts to try to reach out and get people who've missed their appointment to reschedule, rebook and come forward for vaccination. And I would encourage all members, as I know all members already are, to continue to play their part in encouraging constituents to do that.
Rachel Hamilton, to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many colleagues today have raised the issue about no-shows, and I noticed that the First Minister did not respond to Anna Sawa's specific question. So can I ask the First Minister, will she and her government commit to streamlining and improving the system of booking and rearranging appointments, given that many people now have work and family commitments whilst restrictions are easing? And will she commit to publishing the data so better decision-making can be made to ensure no-shows are kept to a minimum as we enter this crucial stage in lockdown easing?
First Minister.
My apologies if I didn't respond to a question earlier on. I'm in some of these questions getting asked, understandably, multiple questions, and I'm trying to answer as many of them as I can while I've got the BDI of the presiding officer urging me to be briefer. On do not attend, we are working on an ongoing basis to try to understand the reasons for people not attending and to address that. There is more of an approach as we go down the age bands for flexible drop-in appointments rather than booked appointments. The online portal for registration is also helping make sure that people's address details are fully up to date. To reassure people, health boards are also on a daily basis overbooking appointments so that if there is a percentage of people not turning up, that is not reducing the overall number of vaccinations that they're doing in a day. So you can look at the daily numbers right now. We are seeing the expected daily numbers, notwithstanding a proportion of DNAs. But for protection purposes, we want to get that down. We publish a lot of information on vaccination. I will look to see what more we can publish as we go through this programme. Our vaccination rates are broadly in line with the rest of the UK. We're all dealing with these challenges. We're all dealing with them in slightly different ways, but we are continuing to make progress and learn and evolve the system as we go.
Julian Martin, to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. South Africa has reported it's entering a third wave and has reimposed lockdown restrictions. And we've also heard reports from Poland, France and Germany. And this week that Professor Ravi Gupta warned that the UK could be heading for the same. I was particularly concerned to see images of people not adequately socially distanced at airport queues over the past week. And can the First Minister reiterate the importance of isolating when returning from abroad, particularly from red list countries? And can she give details on what quarantine arrangements are in place for those who work abroad, particularly in oil and gas?
First Minister.
I'm happy to write to Gillian Martin with specific details about oil and gas. Generally, though, we ask people to comply with the rules that are in place for red, amber and green list countries. We continue to discuss with the UK government on an ongoing basis how we ensure that the controls at the borders are as tight as they need to be. And I won't go into detail, but I have spoken about the frustration I've had about that in the past. And we continue to try to make sure that we have as tight a system as possible. Gillian Martin is absolutely right to draw attention to the fact that this global pandemic is not over. The WHO are at pains almost on a daily basis to remind countries that we are not out of this yet. The UK as a whole is in a relatively strong position because we have one of the highest vaccination rates in the world right now, but we also have the new variant, the new Indian or Delta as it's now called, variant spreading quite significantly. So there's upsides, as I said, but there's also significant challenges, and that means continuing to abide by all of these rules, particularly around international travel, is important. My advice remains to people, unless it is essential, do not travel overseas right now, because that is another important way that we can reduce the risk that new variants of the virus pose to us.
Pauline McNeill, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Does the First Minister agree that it's time for a specific recovery plan for Glasgow, a city that has been in lockdown for 9 months? But serving people beyond its boundary has metropolitan status, where the economic damage has been deep and the vaccine rollout has not matched the density of our population with high levels of the virus. I plead with the First Minister to recognise that Glasgow will continue to be in trouble. It's such an important city for the west of Scotland as a whole, and already 90% of businesses did not qualify for additional support, and I didn't get the impression that this had registered with the government when it was raised last week.
First Minister.
Well, I hope Parliament will recognise that I am not somebody who needs to be reminded of the importance of the city of Glasgow. It is my home. It's also where my constituency is. So I know personally, but I know on behalf of my constituents, how important it is that we get Glasgow out of the current situation, back on track, and then in the medium to longer term, work with the City Council to support economic recovery. The Deputy First Minister has had discussions with the City Council. Their preference is that the government works to support them in the recovery plans, and that is what we will do. The measures we have taken in Glasgow, very specific, bespoke measures over the past couple of weeks, which, as I was saying earlier on, will now inform learning in other parts of the country, have been effective. We are back on a better track in Glasgow, but there will continue to be a need for economic support for a significant time to come, and that is where we will continue to work with the City Council.
Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you very much, President Officer. First of all, I welcome that Inverclyde is moving to level one. But can the First Minister indicate what update has been provided to the cruise line sector with regards to the easing of travel restrictions, bearing in mind how important that sector is to my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency?
First Minister.
If Stuart McMillan will forgive me, I know that is under consideration at the moment, but I am struggling in the moment to remember whether we have taken a final decision and notified that yet or still in the process of doing that. So I'll check that after I'm out of the chamber for the statement and write to him. Obviously, the cruise sector is important economically, important for people who enjoy taking cruises. But we also know from experience at the outset of the pandemic that cruises can pose a high-risk environment as well, which is why continued care and caution around the mitigations that are necessary will be required. But I'll come back to Stuart McMillan as soon as possible.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Figures released this week reveal an increasing number of assaults on police linked to coronavirus. Will the First Minister join me in condemning this sort of abhorrent behaviour and in thanking police officers and staff who have done a tremendous job throughout the pandemic, despite the extremely challenging circumstances?
First Minister.
Yes, 100%. I would very much like to take the opportunity to thank police officers and indeed police staff for the incredible job they have done throughout a year, more than a year now, that has posed significant challenges for them. There is never any excuse for assaulting in any way, shape or form a police officer, but some of what we have heard in recent days is, you know, particularly inexplicable and I think beyond the comprehension of decent people everywhere. This has been a really difficult time for the police, having to police sensitively, as they have done, the regulations in place, you know, help people in a range of different ways, and they deserve our gratitude for the wonderful job that they have done, often putting themselves at risk in the process.
Jamie Green, to be followed by James Dornan.
Thank you. Can I echo the comments just made by the First Minister? But constituents in my region moving from North Ayrshire to Inverclyde to Renfrewshire to West Dumbartonshire are moving from tiers 2 to 1 to 2 to 1 again. To avoid any potential public confusion, can I ask if travel restrictions will remain in place across tiers, and what specific advice has been given to Police Scotland on how they ought to enforce today's latest restrictions?
First Minister.
The areas that the member has just mentioned there, yes, that does involve going from level one to level two areas and back again. But that is because we are not taking a one-size-fits-all approach. If I was to follow the advice I think Douglas Ross was giving me earlier on, there would be many more subdivisions of that, and people perhaps within Inverclyde or within one of the Ayrshire councils would be going from different levels of restriction within the council area. So, in a sense, Jamie Green is illustrating my point. The easiest thing to do is have a one-size-fits-all, but it's not the most proportionate thing to do, and in a public health sense, it's not an absolutely necessary thing to do. So we're trying to be as targeted as possible, but also try to recognise the travel patterns that exist. There are no travel restrictions in place underneath levels 4 and level 3, and that means that people are able to travel freely, but it also means that as we give people rightly the ability to do more, we all have to exercise more responsibility and take care. This is not easy, but this is the very nature of having a situation that is not blanket one size fits all. And it's also illustrating why you have to do it at a sensible level and not in the way that I think Douglas Ross has been advising me to do.
James Dornan, to be followed by Neil Gray.
In light of the news around the Janssen one-dose vaccine being approved for use in the UK, can the First Minister give an indication of whether vaccination centres in Scotland will use it and who is most likely to be a priority for receiving it?
First Minister.
It is very good news that the Janssen vaccine has now been authorised for supply in the UK. We are expecting that we will secure around 20 million doses overall for the UK, with Scotland receiving a proportionate population share of all vaccines indeed that are procured. So we would anticipate, although this is not certain yet, that some doses of this vaccine will be available for use in Scotland later this year, and if that is the case we will incorporate that into our modelling. But of course we are basing our modelling right now on the supplies of the vaccines that we know are available and are already flowing through the supply route, and that's what we will continue to do.
Neil Gray, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the First Minister for her statement and understand the balanced decisions that the Government had to take today, particularly around North Lanarkshire's move from Level 2 being delayed. And though clearly we must proceed with caution, can she advise whether the 2-metre rule is under review as we move through the levels? So this is of particular concern for churches in Airdrieshotts who have been in touch with me. And can she also advise what support is available for people who are apprehensive about readjusting to changes of restrictions as we move forward? A particular concern highlighted by mental health charities.
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Neil Gray for two very pertinent questions. I set out, I think, 2 or 3 weeks ago now, that we do intend to have an overall review of physical distancing. We haven't concluded that yet. When we do conclude that, we will publish the outcome of that as we go further into the summer. And if we do stay on track, as I hope we will, then I hope we will be able to reduce the distancing requirements, if not immediately in all settings, then in many settings. And I know churches have a particular interest in this. So it is very much something that is under review. On the second point, I understand, I know people in my own life who have that tentative feeling about getting back to normal again. It can make people anxious and stressful. What I would say to people is take comfort from the fact that we are continuing to take a cautious approach to this. If you have had your two doses of the vaccine, you have significant protection against this virus. But it makes sense to continue to be cautious about face coverings, hand hygiene and distancing for the moment, because these are the things we know help to keep people safe from getting it and transmitting the virus.
John Mason, to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The fan zone for the European Championships was mentioned earlier on. I wonder if the First Minister can reassure my constituents who live near Glasgow Green and are a bit nervous about so many people coming into the area.
First Minister.
Well, I can understand people's nervousness. My constituents also live, or many of my constituents live reasonably close to Glasgow Green as well. These are difficult decisions. On the one hand, all of us want to be able to see Scotland play in the Euros and to see the Euros more generally, to have fans in the stadium, to have the ability of fans to enjoy the tournament more generally. We also want to see events start again and to have the assurance they can happen safely. But on the other hand, I know that people, perhaps those to whom football is not as important as it is to many, think, well, if I'm still under restrictions, why do we have large-scale events? We're trying to get the balance of all of this as right as we can. We're working closely with the event organisers on preparations for the proposed fan zone. The situation with the virus will be continually reviewed in the run-up to the Euros, taking into account all of the latest evidence and information, but the action that we're all taking is not about allowing a football tournament to go ahead, it's about allowing us to get everything or as much as possible in our society back to normal. The arrangements for the proposed fan zone have lots of mitigations in place to minimise risks of transition. I think there's been a meeting today, if not today, then tomorrow, around this, and these matters will continue to be kept under review. We want to allow fans to safely enjoy the Euros, hopefully enjoy being the operative word, and we will work hard to make sure that is the case. But public safety and protecting people against this virus continues, of course, to be our overriding priority.
And Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The news today that East Martinshire, Renfrewshire, East Renfrewshire and North Ayrshire will remain in level two is disappointing and will be disappointing for local people and businesses. But I have been contacted by people in my region aged between 30 and 39 who are anxious that they've not yet been called for vaccination, despite the encouragement of people in the 18 to 29 age group to register. We heard last week from the Cabinet Secretary for Health that the online portal that's used for 18 to 29-year-olds was being urgently looked at to be extended to the 30-plus age bracket. So it would be useful to understand from the First Minister if she will urgently consider looking at that online registration, and indeed, could there be a more standard online booking process, and of course, the walk-in provision for areas of concern, those remaining in level two at the moment.
First Minister.
Firstly, can I welcome Paul Kane to the Chamber. We certainly are considering extending online registration and, you know, as we perhaps go into another round of this vaccination programme, online booking. So these developments will be kept under review. But in terms of over 30s, these appointments should all have been scheduled. So if anybody in that age group hasn't had a letter, then rather than wait for an online registration system, I would encourage them to go through the vaccinations page to check what has happened. And if there has been a missed appointment, to get that appointment scheduled as quickly as possible. So yes, we will consider extending it, but that's not the solution to anybody right now in that age group who hasn't had the appointment they've been expecting.
Thank you. And that concludes the COVID-19 update. I'll take this opportunity to ask that members continue to observe social distancing measures, including when entering and exiting the chamber. And please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the chamber. The next item of business is a debate on motion 144 in the name of Humza Yousaf on health recovery.